Good morning. Welcome to Christ Church as we gather for worship. We're continuing our series about some foundational ideas, and someone shared with me last week that these don't really sound like some of the others. Like we've done other foundation series, and it's been things like love and joy and, you know, those kinds of things. And we're going to continue that today because our foundation today is water, as you can see here and as you can see me standing here at our baptismal font. I'm also wearing today one of my favorite stoles. This was a stole that my wife Amy made for when we were baptizing our children. And so we have both each have a stole like this, and anytime I get to wear it, it's always a good thing because it reminds me of the blessing that it was that we got to be able to baptize our children, and remembering the promises that we made and the commitments we made as parents to help nurture and raise our children in the faith. And so we're going to be talking about water today. So you might want to have a cup of water with you as we worship. I do want to remind you, if you are one who's able to be here in person, on November 13th, Saturday, November 13th, we are going to be participating in what's known as Prepare a Fair. And it is through an organization called People Working Cooperatively. And we're going to be going around in our neighborhoods and doing some yard pickup and cleanup for those who might not be able to do it themselves. So the sign-up link is on the screen for that if you're able to be here in person. To do that, it's going to be on a Saturday. It is a wonderful time. And so come and be a part of that and way that we can show Christ's love in a very tangible and very physical way for people in their lives. Friends, welcome to worship today once again. We're going to lead into worship as we've been doing with a couple of our young people sharing the story for today, which is the story of the parting of the Red Sea. Well, it's actually kind of the whole of the Hebrews being freed from Egypt in general. We're really going to be focusing in worship today on the Red Sea story as we enter into worship today. Grace and peace and love and joy be with you.
Don't be afraid, Moses said, but there's nothing we can do. They screamed, God knows you can't do anything. Moses said, God will do it for you. Trust him and watch. But there's no way out. They cried, God will make a way. Moses said, another minute and I would have been over. But then the strangest thing happened. God made the pillar of smoke move. It moved behind his people and hid them from the Egyptians. Then God sent a strong east wind to blow all night long. It blew on the water of the big sea. It blew into the left and it blew into the right until it blew into the two towering walls of water. And there, right through the middle of the sea, a muddy pathway opened up.
God's people walked across on dry land.
Our scripture reading for today. Obviously, we can't read the whole of the Exodus story, or at least the first part of it. We're going to be reading from Exodus chapter 14 today, from verse 10 through verse 29. Like with the story of Joseph last week, it would be helpful if you want to take a pause or after worship to read through Exodus 1 all the way up to Exodus 14. Get a sense of the larger story of what has gone on. By this point in our story, Moses has been called by God. He has gone to Pharaoh, let my people go. We've had the plagues that have come upon Egypt, and the Pharaoh has said, okay, you may go, and then changes his mind after the Hebrews have begun to leave Egypt and they begin to pursue the Hebrews. And so that's where we pick up in Exodus chapter 14, beginning in verse 10. As I read, I'm going to be just putting up some artistic images that have been painted and created over the years depicting this story. So just take those in and take in the words of this story. As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt you've taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone and let us serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm. See the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you only have to keep still." And then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward." Just quick note, I find it really kind of interesting. Moses says, "Be still, the Lord will fight for you." And then the Lord says, "Move forward." There's something for us to be thinking about with that. But again, Moses hearing from the Lord, "But lift up your staff, stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. And then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his chariot drivers." The angel of God who was going before the army, the Israelite army, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so they turned with difficulty. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." And then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth, and the Egyptians fled before it, and the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers and the entire army that had followed the Israelites into the sea. Of them, not one remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. And thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you. This past Wednesday morning, got news that I was expecting to get, but was still saddened to hear. And that was that my favorite artist, a painter by the name of John August Swanson, passed away. I've used many of his paintings in what we've done in worship and congregational life, and I fell in love with his work when my wife Amy introduced him to me a couple decades ago. In fact, we actually got to meet him. We were visiting California and went to his studio in San Diego, and he happened to be working there that day and got a chance to chat with him and hear a little bit about how he sees the world. And he's a beautiful man. And what I love about his work is the way that, not just how beautiful it is, but how vibrant it is and colorful it is, how he takes, in many cases, stories from the Bible and brings them into these beautiful ways of depicting. Just stunning, stunning works of art. Someday I would love to have an original of one of his paintings in our house, but we got to get the kids through college before that happens. But he passed away this past, actually it was several weeks ago. I didn't see it until just this past Wednesday. And so when I heard about it, I was working through some ideas about this sermon. And I thought, I wonder what he painted about the crossing of the Red Sea. Because he's done so many other stories from the Bible. And so I looked on his catalog, on his website, and as far as I can tell, he never created a public work about either the crossing of the Red Sea or really any of the stories of the Exodus, which really surprised me. You know, with the burning bush and the plagues and with the crossing and others that follow, it really surprised me that he didn't. But I saw something as I went through his other pieces of art. And that was how water figured so much into so many of his paintings. And that connected with something that I'd been feeling about this theme of water for us today. That water, in many ways, is at the center of the stories of the Bible. I mean, you ask someone, you know, well, what is the Bible ultimately about? Well, it's about love, right? God's love for humanity and our love that we're called to have for one another and so forth. And that's true. You know, if you just do a search on the word love, you'll find that it's used hundreds and hundreds of times. At minimum, it's about 600 times, but if you're using some variations, it goes up over 1,000 times. But water is used just as many times. The word water by itself is about 550 times in the Bible, but then you add in variations, waters, rain, oceans, and all these other kinds of things with water, and all of a sudden you're well over 1,000 as well. So maybe not only is the Bible a story about love, but it's a story about water and God's work through water. Obviously, water plays a pretty significant role in our story. A cloud, which is water vapor, right? A cloud which separates the Israelites, the Hebrews, from the Egyptian army over the course of a night. And then that same cloud that leads the Hebrews through the Exodus. But then, of course, the Red Sea, the crossing, the parting, and then the closing of the waters. But you go back, for example, go back to Genesis, beginning of the story that we have in the Bible about creation. Starts out about how the Spirit hovered over the waters, right? And that one of the very first acts is a separation of the waters, whatever exactly that meant, we don't quite know. We looked at the story of Noah several weeks ago and the flood that came. And the story of Abraham, when he and Sarah were waiting for God's promise to be fulfilled, they took matters, if you remember, right, they took matters into their own hands, so to speak. And Abraham had a child named Ishmael with one of Sarah's servants named Hagar. And when the child Isaac was born, they cast Hagar and Ishmael out, just essentially left him in the wilderness. The story of Hagar and Ishmael is she's expecting that they're going to die, but God provides for them a well of water, which sustains them and protects them. God saves them through water. Then we come to our story. Story of the Exodus, story of the plagues, the Nile, the water of the Nile turned from water into blood. You get further on in the Exodus as the people are thirsty in the wilderness. God tells Moses to strike a rock and water will come, and Moses does that, and water comes. You come to the end of the Exodus, and they come to the Jordan River, which was not a huge, deep, rushing river, but God still does a parting for Joshua, leading the people across the Jordan River. So they enter into the promised land on dry ground, just as they entered into the Exodus on dry ground. Get to the story of Elijah, the prophet Elijah. And one of the things that is told about is a competition, so to speak, with him and the prophets of a false god named Baal. Water factors into prominently into this competition that Elijah sets up. When you come to the Psalms, 47 of the 150 Psalms speak of water in some way, including many that tell in song the story of the Red Sea crossing, but others that speak of water as signs of God's presence and protection, maybe the most famous of which, Psalm 23. You lead me beside the still waters and you restore my soul. Get to the prophets Ezekiel and Zechariah. And they speak of a promise of a future vision of the temple of God. And both of them talk about the waters that come down, like a river that comes down from the temple that nourishes the lands below. And that's now getting into the Gospels. You have a baptism of Jesus, right, in the waters of the Jordan River. You have in the Gospel of John the first miracle of Jesus, where he turns water into wine. You have stories of Jesus walking on the water, the story of the miraculous catch of fish. You have the story of Jesus meeting a Samaritan woman, someone who probably, by the way the culture was, someone he shouldn't be talking to at the time. That Jesus shares a cup of water from a well with this Samaritan woman. You have the story of the washing of the disciples' feet with water at the Last Supper. You have the command of Jesus to go and to baptize people in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then the stories in the book of Acts of the baptisms of various people, of Philip baptizing the Ethiopian man on the side of a road using water that just happened to be there, of Peter baptizing Cornelius, a Roman centurion, and his family, and many others that are described in the book of Acts. And then you get to Revelation, the book of Revelation, chapter 22. It has a vision that echoes not only Ezekiel, like we talked about in Psalm, but also Psalm 1, that talks about how the angel showed me the river of the water of life, water as clear as crystal, pouring out from the throne of God and of the Lamb, flowing down the middle of the city's main street. On each side of the river is the tree of life, producing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month of the year. Its leaves are for the healing of the nation, and there will no longer be any curse. And the throne of God and the Lamb will be in this city. His servants will worship him, and they will see God's face, and God's name will be on their foreheads. Night will be no more, and they will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, because the Lord God will shine on them, and they will reign forever and ever. That's just a few of the examples of how water is a part of God's work in the world. Yeah, many of those references to water in the Bible are, he had a drink of water. I mean, it's not big things, but many of them are central to the work of God, about God's restoration, God's healing, God's renewing, God's forgiving, God's giving of life, and so much more. And we ourselves, many of us began our faith journeys in the waters of baptism. Maybe at a font like this, maybe in a river, maybe in a big pool, maybe somewhere else. But in the waters of baptism, we began our faith journeys. We remembered the stories of God's work through water, the flood, the Red Sea, water into wine, and all the others that we named. And we were reminded and felt that promise upon us, cross made on our foreheads or water poured over us, sign of the renewing and the restoring of God. Water is at the center of the working of God in our world. And so, in our world where we recognize how central water is to our very lives, I mean, you can go as a human being a lot longer without eating than you can without drinking. And we see the struggles that are present for many people in the world today about water scarcity and water insecurity. People who don't have access to clean water because of corroded pipes in cities, or because of contaminated wells, or people who have to walk miles just to get a jug of water and carry it back to their homes. Lakes and rivers that once were deep and ran strong that are drying up right now. We remember how central water is to our very lives. And we see in these stories how central water is to the work of God in the world. So as we think about this foundation, I want to ask you to do something this week. Every time you do something that has to do with water, and I mean every time, a shower or a bath that you take, when you go into a bathroom, when you get a cup of water, when you water a lawn, when you make coffee, when you wash your hands, the list can keep going on and on and on. Remember, God's working in your life. Maybe use that moment to pray for something going on in your life, to give thanks for the gift of water that you have right at that moment, to pray for those who face water insecurity in our country and throughout our world. Maybe to be led to support organizations and do things that can help meet the challenges of water insecurity in places in our world. It may be filling up a bottle of water that you own and use that throughout the day rather than buying a bottle off a shelf. But use those moments where you interact with water, you use water to remind you of God's work through water in the past and in your life today, and how God will continue to use that into the future. Friends, the story of the Exodus, it's a story of setting people free. And it happens through the gift of water. That's what baptism speaks for us. God setting us free from bondage of sin and death through the gift of water. And water can remind us of how we are called to share that gift with one another and with the world. Amen. Thank you. for our prayer today. I'm going to be using a prayer written by a woman named Christine Longhurst that she wrote for World Water Day, which is in March of each year. There will be points where I will say, "O healing river," and your response will be, "Pour down your waters and heal your people." So wherever you are, I invite you to speak those words along with. Let us pray. Holy God, whose spirit moved over the waters at the dawn of creation, hear our prayers for all who thirst today. We pray for those who are spiritually thirsty, who long to know your presence but don't know where to find you. We pray for those who are alone and without hope, those who long to feel needed and loved, those who are searching for meaning and purpose. O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. We pray for all who are physically thirsty, who don't have enough water to drink or to feed their animals, whose fields are parched, whose crops have withered, those who have to walk long distances to find enough water to survive or have to be content with water that is unclean. We pray for those whose homes and villages are torn apart because of drought or famine. O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. We pray for those who are thirsty for justice, who long for an equal sharing of resources among peoples and nations, those who put their lives at risk to protect streams and rivers and oceans, those who are working to find clean water and make it available to those who need it. O healing river, pour down your waters and heal your people. God, we ask that you would open our hearts to the needs of all who thirst. Give us courage to work together for justice, to stand alongside those who are thirsty, so that people everywhere may live without want or fear and may discover the abundant life you promise to each one. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of living water, we pray. Amen. So if you have a cup of water with you, just dip your fingers in there. Feel that water. Get it on your hands. Let it be a reminder to you of your baptism, of the mark that God has placed upon your life. But may it also remind you of one of these stories that we mentioned today, the Red Sea story, which was at the center of our story for today, or many of the others. The story Jesus walking on the water, or the story of a miraculous turning water into wine, or any of a host of the others. Maybe just the comfort that it brings to know that God walks with you. That's the still waters of Psalm 23. Let that be a reminder to you of God's presence, God's forgiveness, God's healing, God's restoration, God's provision, and so forth. But may it also lead you to be a part of bringing that water of life to others in the name of Jesus Christ. Grace, peace, love, and joy be with you today. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.